So thank you for joining and welcome to my presentation. You have seen the title and the work I will talk about today that relates to my research studying mechanism of recalcitrant plant biomass degradation. I'm studying mainly biological processes, degradation processes, and in my teaching, we have also, of course, a very nice teaching job at the university. I teach mainly about applied entomology. So maybe a few sentences of my history so far. After my PhD and a postdoc, I worked for about 5 years at a company named Nedalco. And at that time, I contributed to the implementation of a C5 fermentation by baker's yeast to produce fuel bioethanol. And later on, that was taken over by DSM and POET. And well, they are using this technology. But I realized that actually my passion is more into research and into discovering the unknown. Actually, I really enjoy guiding young scientists as well. So then I started as an assistant professor in 2011. So just around the time, I guess, that Francisco heard my presentation. And there I'm within the laboratory of food chemistry, working on lignocellulose biochemistry. And on average, I have around 4 to 6 PhD students, postdocs, and we are working together, of course, with technicians. And the group size of food chemistry is a little bit larger. We have different topics we are dealing with, around 25 to 30 PhD students normally. So what are we dealing with? Well, I think also in your work, if I understand the background of this symposium series, is that we are all trying to use plant biomass for, let's say, the whole range of food, fuel, feeds, chemicals, and materials. So actually also the non-food part we would like to use. And in the Netherlands, where I'm from, we are more also working with wheat straw or other agricultural and food industrial side streams, and not so much with wood. And I can imagine that in the north of Europe, much more effort is also put into the fractionation and the use of the wood components. But nevertheless, some of these components are the same. So the characterization of these polysaccharides and lignin fractions are more or less the same. In the end, by making use of this biomass, we kind of recycle carbon and eventually CO2. And in my university, so Wageningen University and Research, that fits into the strategy we have around connected circularity. And as I've said at the beginning, of course, it's a very broad team. And in my research, we mainly focus on biological conversion of plant biomass polymers. Good, and today I would like to give you a little bit more insight into the fine molecular structures of hemicelluloses and lignin. So a little bit of a background slide here to get you all aligned. If we're talking about plant biomass and the polysaccharides and the lignin structures there, we're actually talking about the plant cell wall. Because the plant cell wall comprises the largest part of the dry matter of this plant biomass. And then the plant cell wall, if you look at the architecture, is kind of built of a secondary cell wall and on the outside here, the primary cell wall. Well, as I've said, the majority of the dry matter is built from the cell wall. And if we talk about the grasses, but also talk about woods, then the majority of this dry matter is secondary cell wall material. Then to go further into detail on the secondary cell wall, what do we have? Well, this is a bit of a schematic overview, but the majority there is the polysaccharide cellulose, and we have some hemicellulose accompanying the cellulose. And we have the non-carbohydrate polymer lignin, which is kind of gluing this network together. Another background slide to already indicate what are we actually talking about. So here I have listed more or less the main plant cell wall polysaccharides. In all plants, in the secondary cell wall, we find cellulose. Well, cellulose is a beta-1,4 linked glucan polymer depicted on the top. Then the hemicellulose is mostly xylem. And then in grasses, we find a xylem structure, which has a backbone of beta-1,4 linked xylosyl units with arabinose branches or glucuronic acid branches. So in grasses, we name this structure glucurono-arabino-xylan, while in hardwoods, the xylan has mainly glucuronic acid side groups and acetal groups, and therefore we name this structure glucurono-xylan. In softwoods, there can also be found a bit of xylan, but in addition, the hemicellulose galactoglucomannan can be found. Now, in my presentation, I will also talk about xyloglucan and not so much about pectin. These are also plant cell polysaccharides, but it's good to realize that these xyloglucan and pectin are primary cell wall components. So that doesn't mean that they do not occur in wood. They also occur in wood, but the amount in the dry matter of primary cell walls is very low in wood. So that means that the amount of xyloglucan or of pectin in wood is relatively low compared to cellulose or xylan. Okay, in this presentation, I would like to provide some more insights in analysis of this fine molecular structures of the hemicelluloses. And at the end of my presentation, I will also provide you some information about analysis of the structure of lignin. I would like to already mention that in my presentation, I will not discuss molecular weight distribution, although it's a very important aspect of the molecular structure, of the understanding of the polysaccharides what you have. However, I've seen that in this symposium series, you will also have a separate presentation about size exclusion chromatography and molecular weight distributions. So I decided to keep that out of my presentation to have a bit more space for other chromatographic analysis. So to start with the hemicelluloses, where do you start? Well, first we start to look at the primary structure. And then the primary structure can be defined by these four bullet points here. So we start with the nature of the building blocks. So the type of the building blocks. Do we have, like on this example, a xylose unit or a glucose unit or a glucuronic acid unit or an arabinose unit? The ring size matters. Do I have a pentose sugar or a hexose sugar? The number, of course, number of xylosyl units, the number of arabinosyl units. But also the sequence will define in the end the primary structure. So that is about the building blocks. The second point is about the type of linkage between those two building blocks. So here we look at the enomeric configuration, alpha or beta, and we define which OH group is linked to the other. So we have 1,4 if the 4 is linked to the 1, and we have 1,2 if this 1 is linked to this 2. As a third bullet, we look at the non-carbohydrate substituents. So on this example below here, for example, here you have this acetic acid group, what is esterified to this OH. So this is a non-carbohydrate substituent. And then as fourth bullet, which is a little bit more of a challenge to analyze, but what in the end defines the primary structure is how are these side groups, side chain substituents, how are they distributed over the backbone? Are they all grouped together, or are they nicely distributed over the backbone, every two backbone units, for example? So as a start to look at these structures, what we usually do is first isolate or fractionate the biomass material to get a more pure fraction or a more pure fraction of polysaccharides, or a fraction in which the polysaccharides are at least accumulated. If we want to focus at plant cell wall polysaccharides, then we should remove starch. Well, then again, if I link to wood, that is not so much of an issue, but maybe you can imagine we also study grains. And then when we look into grains, of course, we have a lot of starch, and starch is also a glucose molecule, so sometimes interfering with the analysis of cellulose or xyloglucan. We also would like to remove proteins and colorants, phenols, etc. However, when you do this isolation, it is good to take care that you're not really changing the polysaccharide structure, or at least if you are changing it, that you are aware of what changes you are getting. So sometimes in this isolation procedures, we make use of a high pH alkaline solutions, and then we will lose all the ester groups. Under certain conditions, it can be that endogenous enzymes, so present in the biomass, become active during your isolation procedure. That means that you are changing the molecular weight, for example, of your polysaccharides, and that is something you would like to prevent. So then inactivating endogenous enzymes at the beginning of your fractionation is usually wished. So here I have one example of fractionation of polysaccharides. There are many types of fractionation procedures. You can also find them in literature. And if you are aiming for fractionation, I would advise you to study this beforehand and keep in mind what you would like to reach. So in this example, we would like to reach the extraction of hemicelluloses in a separate fraction, but we accept that we lose ester substituents. Well, if we accept that, then after having made some what we name alkyl insoluble solids, so we have a wash with 70, sometimes 80% of ethanol. We wash out all the small soluble sugars, and everything what is in the insoluble fraction is the cell wall material. Then we extract the cell wall material with 1 molar of a KOH solution, where we added sodium borohydride to prevent the peeling of the polysaccharide. And then everything what goes into solution is hemicellulose, mostly xylene. You can already co-extract a little bit of lignin. Due to the high pH, as I've said, you will lose any ferulic acid esters or acetal esters already here. Then as a second step, because we know that with 1 molar alkaline solution, you will not extract all the hemicellulose, you can go to a stronger KOH solution to extract the more stronger bound hemicelluloses. So xylene, again, xyloglucan can be extracted. And then in your residue, you have mainly cellulose. As I said, there are many alternative fractionation procedures. There are also procedures which focus on remaining the acetal groups on the polysaccharides. But as a consequence, you have then to accept that you will degrade the xylenes to a certain extent. Well, I will not go into further detail there. But anyway, in the end, you will get fractions which are enriched in your hemicelluloses. So then, what is the strategy to analyze this isolated polysaccharides? Well, usually we start with a rather simple, straightforward monosaccharide analysis, focusing on the composition and also on the content of each of these constituents monosaccharides present. The principle here is that you use an acid hydrolysis, usually sulfuric acid hydrolysis, to degrade your polysaccharide into the monomeric building blocks. And then the monomeric building blocks are identified and quantified via HPLC procedures, or after derivatization by GLC, gas chromatography. Well, if you have still your non-carbohydrate substituents left, not in the case of the alkaline extracts, but sometimes you have them, then we will also look at them by identifying them with HPLC analysis. As a third step, it is important to look at the linkages between the building blocks. For that, we can use something named methylation or linkage analysis. And then eventually, if you have enough material, you can make use of NMR. All different types of NMR are available to further dig into your molecular fine structure. That is not the approach I would like to explain today. I would like to explain today that with after you have fractionated, that you can also fragment your polysaccharides, either chemically or with enzymes, and then analyze the obtained oligosaccharides. We see them as so-called here diagnostic oligosaccharides, and use these structures to redesign back your polysaccharide structure. Well, the advantage of that is that the oligosaccharides you have are smaller, are soluble in many solvents, and that makes them suitable candidates to be separated and identified with chromatographic and mass spectrometric techniques. So I will now show you a couple of examples on how that works. So as an example, I would like to look into corn fiber hemicellulose. Corn fiber hemicellulose is a typical glucuronoarabinoxylan, and I've provided here a schematical structure. Of course, now I already give you a little bit of the answer, but at the time we did this research, we could not draw this structure very well yet. So what we, in the research overall, what we were focused at was to degrade the corn fiber hemicellulose into oligosaccharides, fractionate the oligosaccharides, and then in the end, quantify and also identify the structure of this oligosaccharide. By the way, all these symbols are general symbols used in glycobiology, glycoscience. And if you're interested to find out all the symbols, you can find them via this website. So as I said, the first step we wanted to do there was to obtain the corn fiber hemicellulose. And for that, we first did a pretreatment. I'm not going into further detail here. And then we got a soluble fraction and an insoluble fraction. And in the soluble fraction, we had more than 95% of the corn fiber hemicellulose. Then in that research, we wanted to get rid of the easy part of the hemicellulose. So we added some enzymes. And then we did a fermentation to take out the monomers. And here we accumulated them, mainly the enzyme-resistant structures. And that was still about 50% of the hemicellulose. So we had this 50% of the hemicellulose into oligomers. So then we were interested, can we identify this oligomers, this 50%? Because you have a mixture with all kinds of different components, we decided that we first had to fractionate these oligosaccharides further. And here we did a fractionation based on size with a column named Biogel P2. So that's the material of the size exclusion column. And this column looks like this. And because the corn fiber oligomers in the soluble fraction had a color, we could nicely follow the separation on the column because of the yellow color. Then what you kind of do, you collect the eluents coming out of the column from the bottom in this case. And every, what did I do here? Every eight milliliter, you collect a different fraction. Then you determine the carbohydrate content and composition again of all of this fraction. And we made some pools, which we further identified by different techniques. I will come back at that. Now, as a general strategy, we usually first in our lab go for the chromatography, high performance anion exchange chromatography, if we want to look into oligomeric patterns. This method is especially suitable to identify carbohydrates, monosaccharides, but also oligosaccharides. Very briefly, you elute at pH 12, and it's a kind of anion exchange chromatography. And at pH 12, all the sugars are charged, not so much, but a little bit, just enough to be retained to the column, enough to be separated. Then as a detection, we used pulsed amperometric detection, which is very high sensitive and selective detection. And this is one of the instruments in our lab with an autosampler and some Illumence bottles on the top. Yeah, you cannot see a lot, but there's a column oven, the column is inside, and then we have detection. I don't want to say much more. We have some other possibilities with this system another time. And then what you can expect is a chromatogram as given on this slide. This is an example where we have an arabinoxylin degraded with an xylinase enzyme. That's not the message. The message is you can nicely separate xylose from xylobios, from xylotrios, and see all these different oligomers. However, because we elute at pH 12, we will also lose any ester groups present. And so that's also written in the first bullet. And another thing is we can only identify these oligomers when we have standards available. So for simple sugars like this xylobios or xylotrios, you can buy commercial standards, no problem. And you can kind of compare the elution time of these standards with what you have in your mixture. If you do not have any standards available, for example, for all of these peaks over here, then how are you going to find out what they are? So there, HBAEC reaches its limit. It is difficult to connect an HBAEC directly with mass spectrometer, which would help you to identify the peaks further because of the high salt concentration used in the eluents. So you use 1 molar acetate as a eluents to get your oligomers from the column. So although HBAEC is a nice method for my corn oligomers, this was not the right way to go because I didn't have standards at that time. And we also knew that we would have ester groups and we did not want to lose them. So then another screening method, what we are then using is a mass spectrometry method named MALDI-TOF MS, or if you like, in full, matrix-assisted laser desorption ionization time of flight mass spectrometry. Sounds always very impressive, but actually it's a simple method because you have a small target plate, and on one target plate you can add easily 300 samples. So you add only 1 microliter of your sample. And the trick is that you add not only sample, but you also add a matrix solution. And then you shoot on each target with a laser beam, then the energy is transferred from the laser to the matrix, from the matrix to your compounds in the sample. And the compounds from the sample kind of get loose from the plate. They start to fly in the time of flight tube, and then they arrive at the mass analyzer. And the time of flight is different for the different masses, and that defines in the end the value you get. So it's a rapid technique. You get a quick ID about what type of oligosaccharides you have present. Advantage is that you include esters. They are not falling off. They remain in the analysis. Disadvantage is that it's hard to get information below 400 Dalton because the matrix gives a lot of peaks in that area, lower than 400 Dalton. Another disadvantage is because it's a mass overcharge technique. If you have glucose or galactose, you have the same mass. Same is true for arabinose and xylose. So you cannot distinguish between arabinose or xylose, but you can distinguish between a hexose and a pentose. It's not really quantitative. So that's another disadvantage, I would say. And if you have a lot of salts or large amounts of monomers in your samples, then you will also probably get very poor spectra and you need to get rid of these molecules if you would like to improve that. So then back to the oligomer mixtures we got from the corn fiber and the fractions after the biogel P2, so the size occlusion. Then we measured most of these fractions also with MALDI-TOF MS. And what you then nicely see is that from top to bottom, it's the elution time on the size exclusion. So then firstly, we got the larger oligomers and we first got neutral acetylated oligosaccharides. Yeah, that is not something you immediately see from the masses, but if you study the masses and you start to do the calculations, you will find out that these are neutral acetylated oligosaccharides. And then in the later fraction, we obtained the ferulo-elated oligosaccharides. So as I said, a very nice and quick screening. And then we used these fractions, this P2 fractions, to purify further. Well, some of them here are already rather pure, but others had still different compounds present. And then if you would like to continue purification, you can make use, of course, of, again, different types of chromatography. And in this case, I would like to introduce the reversed phase chromatography. Reversed phase, usually it's a C18 material. And the separation then, of course, depends on the type, the exact type of reversed phase color material you use. Why did we choose in this case for the C18 material? Because it will provide a good separation, mainly for hydrophobic oligosaccharides. So in this example I had here, these oligomers contained ferulic acid, and this makes them rather hydrophobic. Then an advantage of reverse phase chromatography is that you can easily couple it to mass spectrometry, because you usually use either methanol or acetonitrile as solvent, and that is compatible with coupling to mass spectrometry. The disadvantage of reverse phase would be that you have no retention of acidic oligosaccharides. So if you have glucuronic acid attached to your oligosaccharides, you will have no retention, so no separation. You will see that you do not always get a good resolution. It depends a bit on the type of mixture you would like to analyze. Then it can happen that you have separation of your alpha and beta enomer. So each sugar has a reducing end, or the sugars we are working with. And then you can have an alpha and a beta form, which are in equilibrium in solution. So if you get two peaks per compound, you get a more complex pattern, of course. But then again, you can work with labeling the reducing end with, for example, fluorescent groups. Then you get rid of this alpha beta enomer separation. And at the same time, you have then found the way to use, for example, UV detector, and that can help you also to quantify oligomers. So we use now this reverse phase, and we actually can do this at a preparative scale. So normally you have a very thin 2 millimeter columns, but for this preparative scale, we have these thick columns of a couple of centimeters thick, very impressive, very heavy if you see them for the first time. And then we were able to purify a couple of these oligomers. Now, this is just an example here. You only see a reverse phase chromatogram with a nice peak. We collected this peak, and then because we did this at a larger scale, we just had enough material to go to NMR, and then with NMR, we could solve this structure. Now, one slide back. We solved the structure of three oligomers in this mixture. And when we had the structure of these three oligomers, we applied the corn, the total mixture. That is not correct. Then we applied some of the P2 fractions on a reversed phase coupled to MS, but then analytical scale. And then because we knew for three oligomers the exact structure, we could read the fragmentation patterns in MS. So if you, maybe I need to explain that a little bit better. So when you first run these fractions then on your reverse phase chromatography, so you get first a separation, you can see all the peaks. And then as a next step in mass spectrometry, you can select the mass And then this mass, you can fragment further in different fragments. So here I have an example where I have mass 1056, and I have two different compounds with the same mass, but they are separated in the reversed phase. Now, if I fragment this two molecules further, so this is one fragmentation pattern, and this is it for the other peak. I will get it out because it's a little bit too much. Then this fragmentation pattern gives you these fragments that can help you then to understand from the parent ion on, if you understand the fragmentation pathway, then this fragmentation pattern can help you to understand the structure of the oligomer. And because we were helped by the three identified oligomers with NMR, we were able to identify this, let's say, pathways of fragmentation. And then this was one of these 1056. The other, also the 1056, had a different fragmentation pathway. Well, that you will agree with me, I think. And then if you look into more detail, let me see. So here we have, we were able to kind of elucidate the structure of these oligomers. Here we also made use of a fluorescent label, but I will not go into detail for that. So by using this approach, in the end, we were able to analyze different groups of oligosaccharides present. Oligosaccharide 1 and 2 were identified by NMR, but following the same pathway principles with MS, we were able to identify these other structures in this box. Then we had another group of oligosaccharides defined. So you have to look a bit more carefully, but then you see that they're all just a little bit different, and we found another group. Now to say one more thing about this fluorescent labeling. So what we then usually do is what is named reductive amination. Then a fluorescent label can be coupled on the reducing end of your oligosaccharide, and you can make use of many different labels. So if you know exactly how much label you add, you can use it also for quantification. But for sure, it is, when you work with MS, it is useful to know what is the reducing end and what is the non-reducing end. Now I would like to continue showing you some results from another chromatographic method, which is named hydrophilic interaction liquid chromatography. So in contrast to the reversed phase I've just explained, this is a variation of a normal phase chromatography. So in this case, we have a polar material, a stationary phase, a scalar material. It can be different types of material, by the way. So now we use actually water as the stronger mobile phase, in addition to also organic phases. So that again makes it very suitable to couple it directly to MS. Well, the advantage of the HILIC then again is that we can separate more oligosaccharide mixtures compared to the reversed phase. Because if you remember still what I said, for the reversed phase, you need hydrophobic molecules. And most carbohydrates are obviously not so hydrophobic. So HILIC is then an alternative chromatography to try out. And here you have three examples, maltodextrins, aribinan oligomers, and these are pectin oligomers. A disadvantage of oligosaccharides and using HILIC is that oligosaccharides from itself have no UV signal. And these chromatographic approaches are usually combined with UV and with MS. An alternative detection method could be this evaporative light scattering detection. If you want to use that, it's a destructive detection, then you need a splitter after your column, and then half of the material, whatever, goes to the ELSD, and the rest then can go to the mass spectrometer. So in a way, that gives you then a detection, a way to identify or to detect the intensity of your oligosaccharides. So we are still using that, although I have to admit that we mainly go for MS nowadays and not so much anymore for the ELSD. Then to go back to my plant cell wall polysaccharide and arabinoxylan oligomers, it turns out that HILIC MS is a nice approach, but it's not that straightforward. So in contrast to the nice separation I showed you on this slide, if you run a couple of arabinoxylo oligomers, you will agree with me, I think, that the separation looks horrible. So we get probably also alpha-beta enamer separation. We get peak broadening. Well, horrible, right? What can we do with this? And now what we did here is, again, HILIC coupled to MS. And what I show you here is only the extracted ion chromatogram of the mass 677. Because in this picture, I show four standards, basically, and all have a DP of 5, so all have the mass 677. On the here, this lowest is only xylose molecules, linear xylopentose, while this one, this code stands for four xyloses in a row, and the second xylose has an arabinose on the two position, and so on. So although the MS helps us to already understand a little bit the separation of these oligomers, it looks horrible. Then what we can do is reduce the oligomers with sodium borhydride. Alternative would be to use these labels, but so that is not the example I'm showing now. The example I'm showing now that we did a direct reduction with sodium borhydride. And then what you see is that you get a very nice improved separation. No more alpha beta enamer separation, of course. So that seemed to be promising, but I have to admit, by performing the reduction, what you will see is you get much more complex fragmentation patterns in EMS. Another sidetrack, we are also working with oxidized oligosaccharides, and there the sodium borhydride reduction. Or actually we used sodium deuterated, borodeuterate as a reducing agent. And there it was very helpful to track the sites of the oxidation. So if you're interested in, characterizing oxidized polysaccharides, then that could also be a way to try out for yourself. Then I would like to show you also some examples for xyloglucan fingerprinting and making use of the same HILIC MS. So in this example, in this research, we actually studied an enzyme, a xyloglucan endoglucanase, but at the same time, we were interested to find out structure of different types of xyloglucan. So what I show on the slide is kind of a general structure of xyloglucan with these different building blocks. So now if I have an enzyme chopping up this structure in the different blocks and I manage to identify the different building blocks, then I can reach two things. I can understand better what my enzyme is doing, and I can understand better the fine structure of the xyloglucan. So this is what we did. We made a digest of a tamarind seed xyloglucan. So this is rather standard xyloglucan with an enzyme. It's not so important now what type of enzyme this is. And then we run it also on HILIC MS. In this case here on the y-axis, this is the total signal we get from all M over Z masses measured. We have the same mixture here in non-reduced version and in sodium borhydride reduced version. And now the non-reduced mixture was not so bad. The separation was actually rather good. Maybe the reduced mixture gives an even a better separation. But as I said, the fragmentation is a little bit more complex. So in this research, we continued with the non-reduced xyloglucan digest. And then we were able to identify all the peaks numbered here. And don't worry, I will not show you all the different peaks. But as an example, I will only show you two. And I guess it looks rather complex. You really need to dig into all these masses, but then you will start to see more quick that this fragmentation can be kind of predict the structure I have shown here. So this building block XXL, we find actually the fragments depicted here. And then we have another other oligomer, and then all these fragments helped us to elucidate the structure as such. And we did that for all the peaks. And with that, we were able to find out that this enzyme we were using can actually perform cleavages on the tamarind seed xyloglucan as indicated by these arrows. And then again, we had also some berry xyloglucan, which has some fucose in addition over there. And we were able to pick up these blocks as well. The same strategy can then be used with another enzyme. And when you do that, you can find out that you find building blocks indicating then that this different enzyme cleaves the xyloglucan at different locations. So, as I said, this strategy can go two ways. One way is to understand better what the enzymes do, but at the same time, it can be used to identify the structure of the xyloglucan. So other types of xyloglucan, for example, XXGG, can also be picked up following this strategy. A challenge still is the quantification of the different blocks, because of course, that in the end defines the total fine structure. Ah, we still have something to look at. That's also good. Then I would like to end this presentation with saying a few words about lignin. Well, lignin is not a polysaccharide, but it's present in all our biomass. So I think it's also important that we understand better the fine structure of lignin. And in some of the research we are doing, lignin is actually only a pain in the ass. It kind of hinders the utilization of the plant carbohydrates. You can think about even in nature, the carbon recycling. Lignin is the most difficult to degrade. Well, we have our white rot fungi, of course. But also when you think about animal feed, animal digestion, there also lignin is not really wished because it's not giving the animal any energy and it inhibits the fiber fermentation in the animal. And also when we would like to convert to polysaccharides into monosaccharides for chemicals, for materials, later for biofuels, lignin can be something you do not want to have. But then again, we also see lignin as a valuable biopolymer. Oh, that goes too fast. So if you know well to fractionate lignin out in a good way, it is a nice source for maybe green chemicals, for sure for materials. So either way, it will be important to understand the content of the lignin. Do you still have it? Can you get rid of it? How much can you obtain from it? And also the structure will be important to understand more of the functionality of the lignin. So also in our group, we had to dig in lignin a little bit more than we thought we would do maybe 20 years ago. And I would quickly like to show you two approaches. One is named analytical pyrolysis GCMS, and the other is 2D NMR. And there are actually very excellent papers from the group of John Ralph and his colleagues about these two techniques, but also about lignin structure, many different types of lignin structure. So a little bit of quick lignin chemistry. Lignin is built from three monolignol units. Let's say this H, G, and S, coumaryl alkyl, conifryl alkyl, and the sinopril alkyl. And via various radical coupling reaction, these units can form a lot of different linkages. However, we can kind of generalize 3 types of lignin for softwood, for hardwood, and for grass. And I had a PhD student who was really handy with ChemDraw, and he drew all these colorful lignin structures. And by the way, this PhD student is colorblind, so can you imagine? Nevertheless, what I show here is that grass lignin is very rich in G and a little bit less in S, but still, while in hardwood lignin, we have more S units compared to G, while softwood lignin has majorly G units. Then most of these linkages between the building blocks for all 3 types are the beta O4 ether linkages. And then it is also good to be aware of the fact that in grass lignin, we have some ester groups, some extra groups. This cumaric acid esterified over here is an example. We have a bit of tricin. In hardwood, you can find a bit of this benzoic acid esterified. So that was about the structure, but it all starts with the content. So usually we would like to know how much lignin do we have? Like we also want to know how much polysaccharides do we want to have? Well, for a long time, a gravimetric approach, Tasson lignin, you might have heard of. And the principle here is you kind of destroy everything what is not lignin with sulfuric acid, you wash that out, and everything what's left as a residue, that is what we name lignin. It is okay to use, but it is not specific. It is also disturbed if you have a lot of protein or chitin in your sample, because that also ends up in your residue. And you need quite a lot of material, to start with. So we were thinking of pyrolysis GCMS as an alternative, analytical pyrolysis GCMS. And I will quickly show you the principle. So you kind of burn your sample at 500 degrees Celsius, but in the absence of oxygen. What happens is that your biomass decomposes, your lignin also decomposes, and what you have left are the building blocks. These building blocks can then be separated by GC and detected by MS. And then the pyrolysis products, or the pyrogram, is kind of a fingerprint of the lignin structure. So in this way, we specifically look at the building blocks of lignin. So it's really a specific lignin quantification method. For quantification, we had to solve an issue that some of the lignin is also disappearing as CO2 or whatever. To make a long story short, we were able to find out a way to use a lignin isolate as internal standard. And this lignin isolate is totally 13C lignin. So we had a 13C wheat straw cultivated under 13 CO2 atmosphere. From that, we isolated lignin. And then we add that to our biomass in pyrolysis. And we get the same pyrolysis of the 13C lignin as that we get of the 13C, as that we get from the 12C biomass. And because we know exactly how much internal standard we add, then we can correlate that to the area of the 13C, which is a mass spectrometry giving you, of course, a distinct area from the 12C peak. I hope you kind of get it, but in this way, we were able to provide lignin contents. We validated this system with first in a model system, and when what we put in is what we get out, so that was really promising. Then we also looked into true biomass. Well, we didn't have a very good comparison, but we kind of compared it then with Clason lignin analysis, which was corrected for ash and protein. And then with our method, we find reasonably the same lignin contents. So we thought that was already nice. A disadvantage is that our method was, when we started to work with it, we used 13C internal standard obtained from wheat straw, which works very well if you want to quantify lignin from other grasses. But if you use it to quantify lignin in wood species and compare that to Clason, it is well, not totally incorrect, but it's not that correct. So apparently the pyrolysis quantification is much, well, not much, it's a bit dependent on the structure you have. So we fine-tune the method. We also isolate the 13C internal standards from wood. And then we could also quantify lignin in the wood samples. This is research in collaboration with a small company in Wageningen named Isolife. And Isolife is also the commercial partner in selling this internal standards. So we also use this method to quantify lignin when we had fungal growth in straw. To quickly show you what happens. So after 7 weeks of growth, depends a bit on the fungal strain you're looking at, but for this Xeroporiopsis subfamispora, we had like almost 70% of lignin removed. And that was the best fungus in terms of lignin removal and also the selectivity, because we did not want to remove the xylin. Then I promise you to also say a few words about NMR. So if you also would like then to know, okay, I degrade my lignin, what do I have left? What's going on? You can make use of 2D NMR. And as I said, John Ralph and his group has some excellent papers and nice examples of how to reach this NMR. To give you a little bit of insight, so you have the aliphatic region, and in the aliphatic region, you see a lot of carbohydrate signal, but you also have here the signal for the main linkage present in lignin, so the beta O4 linkage, and here colored in blue. But we get most of the information from the aromatic region. So here you will see the signals of your rings, so to say. And as an example, for an S unit, this very large red signal over here, that stands for this unit on the left side. So this is a wheat straw lignin, and then you get a picture like this, and you can annotate all the signals. If you like to find the annotation, you can also have a look in this publication over here. And then in our case, we were interested what happened during the fungal growth, and then we got all these extra signals over here. And actually, if you go into more detail, you will find out that what we got was all this C-alpha oxidized lignin structures. Then we measured more samples with NMR, but also with our pyrolysis GCMS, because maybe you remembered, if I get my pyrogram, that pyrogram is also indicative for the lignin structure, the lignin fingerprint. And actually what we could see is that all these C-alpha oxidized blocks, we could also pick up with pyrolysis. So I will not say that pyrolysis and NMR gave exactly the same results, but I think you will agree with me that the trend measured by the two methods is certainly the same. And for pyrolysis, you only need less than 100 microgram, while for NMR, you need quite pure material and larger amounts. This is to impress you a bit. You can do also all kinds of other types of NMR. And with our mixture, we had a lot of different molecules, even more colorful. To make this directly into a conclusion for you, all these colors, what does it mean? Well, it means that in this material, we had quite some benzoic acids, quite a lot of benzaldehydes, and also phenyl ketones. So benzoic acids on the top, here the benzaldehydes and some of these phenyl ketones. And now if you look a little bit further into the structure, what we could do is draw all these pathways. Don't look at it too much. But what I would like to highlight is that by using the pyrolysis and the NMR together, we were able to define more or less four pathways of lignin degradation by the Xeroporiopsis fungus. So with that, I would like to finalize this presentation. I think you should remember that quantification is very important, And also that structural elucidation of molecules at the molecular level is key to understand, in the end, the functional properties, but also enzymes needed to modify them. There are many people who helped in this research. I'm not going to name all of them. And thank you for your attention.